आई एम नॉट अ पर्सन, आई एम अ थॉट. पंडित श्री राम शर्मा आचार्य. अनअवेयर ऑफ माई हायर स्टेट दैट इज एमिनेंस एज द ग्रेट लॉर्ड, ह्यूमन बींग्स फूल्स डिसरिगार्ड मी ड्वेलिंग इन द ह्यूमन फॉर्म. द भगवद गीता 9.11. बुक टाइटल माई लाइफ इट्स लेगेसी एंड मैसेज. हमारी वसीयत और विरासत. बुक इंट्रोडक्शन. माई लाइफ एंड इट्स लेगेसी is the only book written by Pandit Sri Ram Sharma Acharya as an autobiographical account of his entire life story. Not just of this birth, but giving a glimpse of his previous births too. In this short autobiography, which only came into existence because of incessant request from his disciples, who even after 40 to 60 years of being with him, didn't know much as Pandit Sri Ram Sharma Acharya, or fondly known as Gurudev, और गुरुजी टू हिज डिसाइपल्स एज ही डिडेंट यूज टू स्पीक अबाउट हिमसेल्फ. द बुक गिव्स अ ग्लिम्स ऑफ हिज मिशन ऑफ हिज लाइफ दैट वॉज अराउंड ट्रांसेंडिंग डिवाइन फॉर द बैनिशमेंट ऑफ ईविल फ्रॉम द ह्यूमन साइके ऑन अ ग्लोबल स्केल एंड अशरिंग ऑफ अ न्यू एरा ऑफ पीस हार्मनी एंड लव ऑन दिस अर्थ. लॉर्ड कृष्णा हैज अप्रोप्रिएटली सेड इन भगवद गीता अवजानंती माँ मूढ़ा मानुषीम तनुमाश्रितम परम भाव मा जनंती मम भूतमहेश्वरम. अनअवेयर ऑफ माई हायर स्टेट एज द ग्रेट लॉर्ड बींग्स फूल्स डिसरिगार्ड मी ड्वेलिंग इन द ह्यूमन फॉर्म. सच हैज बीन द लाइफ जर्नी ऑफ पंडित श्री राम शर्मा आचार्य गुरुदेव हु री इनकारनेटेड इन सेवरल बर्थ्स इन ह्यूमन फॉर्म्स ओनली टू अपलिफ्ट ह्यूमन काइंड इरेडिकेट ईविल establish interconnectedness in all human beings and establish love and harmony at a global level. Not only did he facilitate Gayatri Mantra to be available to the masses, but he also reclaimed the right for its recital, cutting across the barriers of birth, gender, religion, race and caste. When one starts realizing the enormity of work done by him in his life, one realizes that this extraordinary work couldn't possibly be done by a human body. While only his contemporaries would know of his origin and reincarnation, but to them and everyone around, he remained and lived as a very grounded, simple and loving person throughout his life. Many of his disciples kept urging him to write about his life story and origin, but he avoided writing about his journey, origin and the glimpse of previous births for a long time. However, in one of the Akhand Jyoti, it's a monthly publication of AWGP, and he shared glimpses of appearance of his own guru who lived in astral forms, his own rebirth spread over various centuries. Various requests from all quarters emerged, and that's when the genesis of this book happened, which since then has undergone many editions and expansions. Is actually a written form of what Gurudev was and his life journey. Not only this is a book full of anecdotes from his own life, but moreover a collection of life events where each has the potential to serve as a reference point to any problems or dilemmas faced by any and each one of us on a day-to-day basis, showing a very practical path leading to self-realization, self-awareness and self-transcendence. The sunrise of Gurudev's life. This chapter entails the beginning of Gurudev's spiritual journey, which goes back early when he was 15 years old. Until then, he was associated with Pandit Madan Mohan Malviya, who guided him to recite 5 rosaries of the Gayatri Mantra. Although his soul was well nourished with regular sadhana and upasana, one fine day he got to see and experience his own guru who lived in astral form. His guru gave him a glimpse of his appearance on the festival of Basant Panchami, and that's when Gurudev's spiritual birth happened. The first dialogue with his guru. Being a child, that he was at the age of 15, he got panicked seeing the astral body and wondered if he is seeing a ghost or if he was facing any hallucination. Bewildered and astonished, he asked the purpose of the visit to his house, and in return was comforted by the cheerful demeanor of his own guru. This put a rest to his dilemmas and confusion. His guru showed a glimpse of Gurudev's previous births and provided guidance on his life goal. risen Datra as told by his guru. He further guided Gurudev that he should be directly instrumental in promoting universal welfare. He conveyed that a person having a physical body has to be made a medium and used as an instrument for action in the physical realm, which cannot be directly done through an astral body. He also conveyed that these are critical times and there are great chances of humankind being grievously harmed and overwhelmed by the forces of darkness, and he wanted Gurudev to want to be a medium to help solve the problems bedeviling humanity. He further added, "You will get my guidance and cooperation and your shortcomings will be removed. It is for the purpose that I have come to you." Why did the Guru himself come to the seeker? While a seeker is in search of a true spiritual guide, but the latter is still keener to find a deserving devotee. A devotee, that is sadhak, has to be truly deserving person. Only a person who has refined his thinking, character and attitudes is a true sadhak. He is not required to go in search of a guru. The guide himself appears before him, grasps his hand and shows him the path he has to be tread. He lifts up the sadhak in his lap when he staggers and safely carries him across all obstacles. This is precisely what has happened in Gurudev's own case. His astral guru visited his house uninvited to make him a fit instrument for the execution of his divine assignment. Outlay of action planned by Dada Guru, Pandit Shri Ram Sharma's guru. Dada Guru conveyed the massive action plan that included 24 Gayatri Mahapurusharans. A Purusharan is a strict regime of reciting 2.4 million Gayatri mantras under a very restricted diet and strict living regime, performed which had to culminate in the form of Purnahuti of Gayatri Yajna of 1000 kunds. For expansion, Dada Guru introduced Gurudev with about 1 lakh of persons who were to form the nucleus of the Gayatri mission and would give their wholehearted cooperation in the stupendous task of the spiritual reawakening of the masses that was to happen through him. During their first meeting, Astral Guru had directed Gurudev to come to the Himalayas 4 times for periods of about 1 year each after completing 24 Mahapurusharans of Gayatri. First call of Gurudev to the Himalayas. Gurudev further says, "Hardly a year had passed after my first darshan, that is glimpse of Gurudev in my room of worship on Basant Parv in 1926, when I received a telepathic invitation in early 1927 to visit the Himalayas and meet him again on Basant Panchami Parv. This first pilgrimage lasted for about a month. Although I was not in any haste, I was eager, no doubt, to see that which, till then, was unseen. Others would not have even thought of visiting that region in that season of peak winter and face the hardships, loneliness and danger from wild and ferocious animals. My higher self had to wage a stiff battle against phantoms of fears, safety, security and disinclination to risk hazards for noble aims." Period before his second round of pilgrimage. After the first call to the Himalayas, Gurudev wasn't summoned to the Himalayas for some time and a period of about 10 years has passed since. He further adds, "It was not considered necessary to call me in between. I used to see Gurudev in the same posture in which I had seen him for the first time and he used to express his approval of what I was doing. Never did I feel that I was alone. Throughout these 10 years, I felt that he was always with me. The struggle for freedom of India was continuing. The weather was fine. I again received a message after I had returned from a visit to Sabarmati Ashram in 1937 to reach the Himalayas. His orders could not be ignored. Informed my family members and started for the pilgrimage." The second meeting with his guru. He further adds, "As soon as I reached Nandanwan, a forest area in Himalayas, Gurudev appeared before me in his astral body. My excitement and joy knew no bounds. My lips started trembling and my nose became wet with tears. As a symbol of deep love, he put his hands on my head. The formality of adoration and blessings was thus completed. Gurudev hinted to me about meeting the rishis again for seeking the guidance. I was overwhelmed. The message from the rishis of the Yore. Almost all the rishis of the Satyug, the first of the four times era of human existence phase, lives in this region of inaccessible Himalayas in their astral bodies. I had met them here earlier, although they do not need any specific place or objects for maintenance of their astral bodies. They have each, for their convents, reserved a specific cave. On my first visit, I could simply bow before them and receive their blessings indirectly. This time, I had the privilege to listen to their message as Gurudev took me and introduced me to each one of them. Their forms appeared as a condensed light, but when I became aware of and identified myself with my subtle body, I could see them in the physical bodies in which they lived in Satyug. They were in the same forms in which worldly people see them in their imagination. Necessary formalities were observed. I prostrated on their feet and they touched my head. I was thrilled and was overwhelmed with joy. Revelation of the technique of sublime transformation. How I implemented it in my life. In all these journeys to the Himalayas, Gurudev was someone to be guided on the further course of action for this life journey and how to continue to implement them through his corporeal body by the transformation that is required in this era. He further adds, before I proceed further, it will be appropriate to describe three important phases of my life sadhana which are linked with my spiritual progress. This has been the central point of my successful life journey. If readers of this book are inspired to proceed on this path, they should assimilate the philosophy behind the sadhana, which I have adopted in my life. Mysterious occult events, no doubt, sound interesting, but they are confined only to the person concerned. Hypnotized by such events, if a person performs the same rituals and pays a visit to the Himalayas, he will get nothing. The most important lesson which my soul has learned living in this body is true upasana, that is worship, correct life sadhana and aradhana, which means service of humanity. This is the path which can transform a person into a divine life. Gurudev's assurance. Gurudev further adds, I have resolved to apply the powers gifted to me by divine grace and acquired by sadhana in shaking and transforming eminent persons of the world in the various fields of human endeavor. These include politicians in power, wealthy persons, scientists, thinkers, ordinary looking level, as well as of topmost level. Those who are at the topmost level are mostly egoistic and rigidly opinionated. I am not confining my action to persons of topmost level, but even ordinary looking persons of the aforesaid four types are being taken up within the orbit of the transforming force. The second category within whom I purpose to work is of awakened souls who are mostly born in India. No other country has produced so many great men, rishis, manisis, devtas as India has done. It will be my endeavor to convey the message of Yug Dharma to souls who have accumulated good sanskars during their past births and will exhort them to come out of their illusions. The third category is of persons belonging to Pragya Parivar, with whom I have personal attachment and deep affinity. People do not have, but I have the recollection of their other several past births. I have collected all such persons with whom I had an intimate relationship in the past by coincidence or by deliberate efforts. Akhand Jyoti and constructive programs launched by this mission have been acting as uniting factors in this respect. There is a mutual guardian-child bond of affection between us.